in Python. You can use negative indexing in Python. I just want to know whether you find it very basic. You want me to explain all these points, or shall we directly jump to NumPy and Pandas? I just want to know whether you are very much comfortable with Python. Is it okay to directly go to NumPy? And is it, you find it useful? Otherwise, I'll go a little faster so that we can cover all the.
Ma'am, this is basics, ma'am.
Yeah, this is basic. Oh, how about others? Okay, so let me not explain.
Basic, ma'am. Okay, basic.
Yeah, correct. Okay, now then in the case, I'll skip the very basic ones. Okay, hope you know how to read input in Python. Just you have to use the input command. And then, since whenever you use the input command to read input, it will be in a string format. You can convert it into integer by saying the typecasting. So typecasting means type conversion. If you want to convert one type of data into another type, you will use the data type that you want to convert here, and then the argument in parentheses. Okay, this syntax is different from the syntaxes in other languages. Where in other languages we will mention the data type to which we want to convert in parentheses, and then okay, so here A will be converted to integer. C or C++. If you want to do typecasting, this is the variable name. A is the variable name. I want to convert it to integer, means I will use this format. But in Python, you are saying int of A. That's int of A. So this will convert the string value into integer, and then assign again, once again assign it to A. Okay, so right, and then again you want to read another input, and then you want to process them. Okay, fine. So let me just skip all of them. You have some exercises in reading input. Okay, you can just, I'll share the notebook, you can just go through it. Okay, and then the Boolean data type is like, if you say true plus true, as I told you already, Boolean true stands for 1 and the false stands for 0. Okay, you can say true plus true. So what could be the possible output, you guess? It is going to return the value 2. Okay, because true stands for 1, false stands for 0. Okay, if you say true plus true, then 1 plus 1 is 2. Okay, so again, the output of this is going to be 1, right? And then I can check some conditions. Here, I just want to check whether true is equal to 1. So, what result is this going to return? It's going to be a Boolean value, because I'm comparing, I'm using a conditional statement here. I just want to compare whether true is equal to 1. So, it is going to return me the Boolean value true. Okay. Similarly, once again, if I want to check whether true is not equal to 1, it is returning a Boolean value false. Okay. So let me check the data type of A, where I have assigned the value true to A. Okay. So this is going to be bool. Okay. So now the most interesting and important ones are the data structures. Data structure actually means how you can group a collection of data items under a single name. Okay. So if you want to group a collection of data items under a single name, then we will use any of the data structures. So here in Python, it supports three different data structures. In sequence types, include list and tuple, and the mapping type is a dictionary, and the set type set. Okay, so how you can create any of these data structures is only the difference is what type of enclosing characters you are using to create them. Okay, so if you see the syntax here, I am declaring a variable L, in which I use a square bracket and then include a collection of numbers. Okay, so but list could be a collection of any type of data item. One value could be an integer, another value could be a floating point number, another value could be a string. Any kind of characters, you can group them together under a single name in a list. Okay. Okay, so now I have included only, if you want, I can also include some strings here. Something like this, okay, and I can also include some floating point values. Okay, it is possible. Okay, in a list you can include a collection of values of different types. So now if I check the type of A, it is of type list. Okay, what is the length of the list? LEN is a method, is a built-in function which will help me to find the number of values in this particular list. So there are 11 values in this list. Okay, so now I just want to access the individual elements in the list. So what can I do? Again, you have to remember is the indices always starts from 0 in Python. Okay, so if you access the if you want to access the first element, you have to use the index 0. So this will give me the first element in the list. The first element in the list is 2. Okay, I just want to assign a value to the first element. Okay, already the first element is 2. Now I don't want to have this value. I want to assign the value 81 to the first position. Okay, how can I do that? L of 0 is equal to 81. So now if I print once again the list, if I print the list once again, what happens? So now the value 81 is available at position 0. Okay, now I just want to print the same concept. Okay, so if you want to print a range of values in a list, so how many values do you think it will print? How many values is going to print starting from position 2 to position 4? Okay, it will print only 3 values, right? Okay, and then if you want to find the minimum value in the list and the maximum value in the list, you can find it out. I have also included some strings here, so that is the reason why it says it cannot find the minimum and the maximum value. So if all the values are of same type, then I'll be able to find the minimum and the maximum value. Okay, so I just want to sort it again. This won't work for me because I've added some let me delete this. Okay, now I write minimum value. Okay, so now I just want to sort my list. So if I use a sort command, I'll be able to sort my list in ascending order. If I want to sort it in the descending order, then I'll say reverse is equal to true. Okay. So this count function will help me to identify the number of occurrences of the value 12. How many times the value 12 occurs in my list. Okay. So the value 12 occurs twice in my list. So the result is 2. Okay. So now this is very important thing that you have to note down. Now I assign the list L to another variable list. Okay. It is something similar to saying A is equal to B. So in other programming languages, if I say A is equal to B, and later if I say A is equal to A plus 1, it will only modify the value of A, not the value of B, right? But here if you check, I assign the list L to list. Okay. So okay, now I print the list. Okay, later what I do, I just assign the value 45 to the position 3, at index position 3. In the index position 3 is this. Okay, the value is 32. Instead of 32, I just want to store 45. Okay, now what I do, I print both list and L. I print both list as well as L. What happens? In both the list, the element at index 3 has been changed to 45. Even though I have changed only the value of list, it is getting reflected in L also. Okay, so you understand what happens exactly at the background. Anybody is able to guess? Whenever I assign like this, what happens is it is only creating an alias name for an existing location. Okay, so L must have occupied some location in memory, right? So now if I say list is equal to L, what happens is to the same memory location is referenced by another name list. So whatever changes you make to list, that is getting reflected in L also. Okay, able to follow how it works? So it's just an alias name. Whenever you make an assignment statement like this, it is creating an alias name for an existing variable or an existing data structure. That's it. So whatever changes you make to the new variable, it is going to reflect in the original variable too. Okay, so to avoid that, if you want to exactly create a copy, if you want to create a new list which you want to store it in a different memory location, then you will use the copy method. Okay, so if you say I just want to create a new list LC, list copy, and then I say L dot copy. Now I change the value at location 3 to be 25. So now once again I print list copy and L, LC and L. What happens? So LC contains at location identified by index 3, 25, the value 25. Just I change here, right? It has got the value 25, but the original list has got the older value itself. Whatever value it has got earlier, the same value is being retained. Okay, you understand the difference between assigning an existing list to your new list? What happens? It is just creating an alias name. You always remember that. So only when you make an explicit copy of an existing variable or an existing data structure, it will occupy a new. Okay. So now I just want to check the index of the value 32. There is no value 32 here in L. Is there a value 32 in L? No. So it is going to return me what? Error. Because there is no value 32. Okay. So let me change the value to, I just want to check for the index position of 45. Okay. So the index of 45 is again 3. Okay. So now, I just want to remove the element 32 from L. Is there an element 32 here? No. So let me say I just want to remove 5. There are two occurrences of the value 5. So if I want to remove 5, what happens? So only the first occurrence of the value 5 is being removed from the list. Okay, able to follow how it works? I just want to remove the element 5. There were two occurrences of 2 times the value 5% in the list, but only one, the first occurrence is being removed. Okay, so now I just want to reverse a list by using the command reverse. Okay, so here, so if you print a list L, it is like this. Now after reversing, it is printed because already it is being sorted, right? That is the reason why it is in the it is not a sorted list, okay. But this is a sorted list, right? Okay, it is not sorted. Fine. So next, I just want to pop. I apply the pop command to remove any of the element in the list. So if I say L dot pop and assign it to Z, okay, remove the value from the index of the list. So I just want to remove the element at index 5. So the pop command, the remove command takes the actual value. Okay, the argument for the remove command is you will specify the actual value, but the pop command takes an index as the argument. Okay, so this will remove the element at position 5, not position 5, index 5. Okay, so in this list, L, which is at position 5, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it is going to remove 12. So I think this is the list L. Let me check. See here, it has removed the element 12. Okay. I have printed whatever element I have removed. Now it is, since there are two occurrences of the element 12, only one time it is present now after removing the. So understand the difference between remove and pop. For remove command, you have to specify the actual value in the list. For pop command, you have to specify the index position. Okay, right. And then I create two different lists and then I extend L1.extend L2. Okay, what will happen? At the end of L1, the elements of L2 will be added. At the end of L1, the elements of L2 will be added. Okay. But here, the difference between extend and append command is, all the elements of the list L2 will be added as a whole list. Okay. So there are only 4 elements here in this list. Okay. If I print L2, how many elements are there? L2 contains 4 elements. The last element of the list is another list, okay, which again contains 3 more elements, okay. But here this list contains 6 elements. You understand the difference? This list contains 6 elements. But this list contains only four elements, whereas the last element of this list is again a list. Okay? So, if you want to clear the content of a list, you will say dot clear. Okay? So, that is about the list. And then you will just move on to the tuples. Okay? So, tuple is again a kind of immutable data structure where you cannot change the values in the tuple. Okay, unlike the list where you can, if you want to change one value, replace it with another value, you can very well do that, right? But in tuples, you cannot do that. So, how you can create a tuple? By using parentheses. How you can create a list? By using square brackets. By enclosing a list of values in square brackets, right? You can create a tuple by enclosing a list of values in parentheses. Okay? Now, let me check the data type of T. T is a tuple. So, what is the usage of count function? The same thing which we have discussed for list also. Count function will give me how many times the value 12 occur in the tuple 12, the tuple T. Okay, that is the meaning of count function. I'm sorry. So, the value 12 occurs twice. Okay, what is the index of 12? It will show the first index, means the first occurrence, index of the first occurrence. So, it is appearing in index 1 as well as in index 2, 3, 4. Okay, index 4. Index 1 and index 4. So, it's showing me the first occurrence. Okay, now I just want to assign value 100 at location 0. Okay, will I be able to do that? I'll get an error here. Why? Because tuple is a immutable data structure. Once created, I cannot change the value. That have been already available in the data structure. So, I cannot assign any value to the elements in the data structure. Okay, dictionary is a very useful data structure in Python. Okay, it's like a mapping kind of data structure where you will be able to create the elements in the format of a key value pair. Okay, so how you can create a dictionary? By using curly braces, by enclosing a list of values within curly braces. Okay, so it is in the format of key value pair. Okay, so key is going to be something and value is going to be. There are three elements in this dictionary. The first element key is name, second element key is age, third element key is address. What is the value for the key name? John Wick is the value. For age, the value is 47, and for address, the value is N by stands for New York. Okay, so what is the data type of this D? It's a dictionary. Okay, so now I can also create a dictionary like this where the key is 1 but the value is a list again. Okay, key is a single string but the value is a list of values. Okay, so key is a single string, value is a list. Key is a single string, value is a list. So, okay, I have created two different dictionaries. One, the name of the first dictionary is D. The name of the second dictionary is DD. What is the length of DD? How many elements are there? Can you guess how many elements are there? There are three keys, right? There are three keys, three values. Okay, so it's going to be three. Okay, I just want to know the keys of these commands are very useful when you are writing extensive programming in Python. Because sometimes you may need to process the entire data set based on keys and then fetching the values based on the keys that are available and then process them. So, listen carefully. So, I just want to access the keys in the dictionary. Okay, I say dd.keys. The keys are name, age and address. Okay, I just want to access the values. So, the values are the names, list of names, list of ages and list of addresses. Okay. So, now the next one is, I just want to know the items. Okay, so items is a method which will return both a key value pair combination as a list. Okay, it is going to return it as a tuple. Okay, so now I just want to pop name. Okay, so as I already told you, if you are going to use a pop command, you have to mention the index. So, here instead of index, I am going to use the key. Okay, so the meaning of pop command is it is going to remove this particular key. So what will happen? Once I say pop name, So the resultant dictionary will have only two elements, age and address. The name is big. So whenever I remove the key, automatically the it will be removed along with its value. Okay. Right. So now I just want to get the age. I just want to get the value of. So whenever I use the get command, and then if I specify a key, it will get me the value associated with this key. Okay, the value that is associated with this key. So since I'm using the DD dictionary, I'm using the DD variable. This variable contains the values available in this variable in this dictionary or a list of values, right? So there are two values for each. So I'll get a list. See here, 47 and 50. Okay, so if I use d.get, there is only one value for each. Okay, again the same concept. If you want to create, you can use the copy command. So if you want to clear the content of a dictionary, you can use clear. Okay. Supposing if you want to form, now I have cleared the existing content of, D. Now I just want to form new keys. So if I enclose a string like this, what will happen? You just see the output. It is going to create the key as A, B, C, D. Values are not assigned so far. Okay, it has created a dictionary using the characters available in the given string. Okay, so A is the first key, B is the second key, C is the third key, D is the fourth key, but the values are not assigned. Therefore, it is showing it as none. So if you want to assign values, you can do it like this. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, I have assigned a value like this. Now, once again, if you display the dictionary D, A is 11, B is not assigned, C is none, D is this, but we didn't have a key called E. We have assigned a value, therefore if it is not present, it will create one. If it is not present, it will create one and then assign that value. Okay, I just hope you have understood. I'm going a little fast because these are all very basic things. And then let me move on to the sets concept. Ms. Reena, I hope the pace is fine and the participants are comfortable with the flow.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now I'll just move on to the next data structure, sets. So it is the same format. You can use again the curly braces to create a set like the dictionaries. But the difference is, if you specify only the values, then it will automatically assume data type of set 1 as set. Okay, how the Python interpreter is going to determine whether it is a dictionary or a set? Because both of them are using the curly braces to enclose the values, right? What is the difference? Set is going to have only the values, but dictionary will have key value pair, is it not? Okay, so now if I check the data type of, after assigning this, if I check the data type of set 1, it is going to be a set. Again, what is the length of set 1? How many elements are there? There are 12 elements. Why does it say 12 elements? Always set will include, consider only the distinct values. Even though there are some repetition, some values are being duplicated in the set, the length will display only the number of unique values in the list. See the number of occurrences of the value 4, how many times is being occurred. Okay, so you hope you understand the set, how it calculates the length. It will consider only the number of unique values in the list. Okay, so now if I print set 1, even though I have assigned so many values, when I print it, it will print only the distinct values. It will not show the duplicate values, because always set will include any particular value only once. Okay, so now I just want to perform the basic operations on sets, union, intersection, difference. So these are all some of the algebra operations that you can perform on sets. So obviously you know what is the meaning of union. So if an element is present in both the, union is, it will try to combine the unique values in both the sets. It will try to combine the unique values in both the sets. Okay. And intersection will try to identify the elements that are common to both the sets. Okay. Difference will try to identify the elements in one set which are not there in another set. Okay. Right. So if I can show you the output of these commands, you will be able to understand how it exactly works. These are very simple concepts. I hope you are with me, able to follow. Okay, symmetric differences, difference between the two sets, that is all values not similar in both the. Okay, this is the opposite to intersection. Okay, intersection will do what? The elements that are common to both the sets, right? The elements that are common to both the sets. Okay, so this is the difference between the two sets. All values that are not similar in both the sets. Okay, the elements that are not present in both the sets will only be considered. Okay, supposing if you take any element 1, if you take the element 1, if it is present in both the set, then it won't be fetched as output. Supposing if it takes element 3, this is present only in set 1 but not in set 2, then it will be fetched. Okay, so these are all the elements that are available in only one set, not in another set. Okay, that is the meaning of symmetric difference. This difference is all the elements in set 1 that are not available in set 2. Okay? All the elements in set 1 that are not available in set 2. Okay? So, that is difference. So, if you do set 2 dot difference set 1, then all the elements in set 2 which are not in set 1. So, that is the difference of set 1 and set 2. Okay? And then moving on to the flow control statements in Python. So, how you can use the conditional statements in Python is you can assign some values and then you can check, you can use the relational operators, logical operators, okay? So you can check whether you can use the logical to combine two conditions, you can use the AND operator, okay? I just check whether A greater than B and A greater than C and then print this. So just you have to check the difference in syntax, unlike the other programming languages in which we are much familiar, C, C++, Java, where we use the same syntax but enclose this in parentheses, right? And then if there is only one statement, curly braces are not required. Otherwise, you will enclose, if there are multiple statements, you will enclose them within curly braces. But here, you will include a colon. Okay, you will include a colon and the tab indentation is very important. You have to tab the command, the statement that is to be executed once the condition is true, okay, it has to be indented to the right. Otherwise, there's no meaning, okay. This indentation is very important in Python. Similarly, if that condition is false, it is going to come to the else part. So, how we are writing else if here? Elif, okay. It is not else space if, it is one single word, elif, okay. And then, again, I mentioned two conditions. Two relational conditions combined with the logical operator and then put a colon here, and this is the statement to be executed when this condition is true. Okay, and finally a simple else. Okay, a simple else. Okay, I'm going to get the output as C is the greatest value. Okay, so similarly you can try this, how you can find a grade for a given marks. I'll be sharing the notebook with you. You can find out for the given mark what is the grade. Okay, and then going to the looping structures in Python. The for looping structure, the similar syntax you will have in Java also, but most probably we'll be using even in for statement, we will be using for I in 1 to 10. Where the I is used as an index for the given data structure. But here, if you see here, I'm creating a list using the range function 0, 5. Okay, I'm creating using the range function 0, 5. As I already told you, this will create a list with 5 elements starting from 0 up to 4. The ending point is not included. Okay, so I'll get a list with elements 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Not 5, okay? So, the length of the list is going to be 5. There will be 5 elements in this list. Okay. So, now, if I say for x in range, what will happen? This x will loop through, this x will loop through the values in the list. It is not an index for the values in the list, okay? It is not an index. It will actually loop through the values in the list. Okay? The actual values are 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Those are the actual values. So x will loop through each of the values. So if I say print x, what do you think it will print? It is going to print 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. That is what it will print. Okay. So now, again, I use the range function. Here I say 0, 5, 2. The range function will take an initial the final value, and then the step. The step size is 2. So initial value is 0. The next value is going to be 2. And the third value is going to be 4. Okay. And the fourth value is going beyond the end point. Okay. Therefore, only three elements it will have. 0, 2, 4. Okay. So if I print Z, what I will get? 0, 2, 4. Okay. So now I just want to print what is L3. L3 is this. Okay. Now I just want to make use of for item in L3. Just again I am printing the elements in the list. So it will print like this. Okay. Again I use 0, length of L1. Okay. Length of L1. L1 I don't know what I have initialized L1 with. Okay. Okay. Let me, if you want, we can print L1 here. I just insert a new cell. Insert a new cell. Print L1. So L1 is a list containing 6 elements, okay. So length of L1 is going to be 6. So if I say range of 0, 6, what are the possible values in this list? If I say item in range of 0, 6, length of L1 is 6. Length of L1 is 6. Therefore, what are the possible values the variable item will loop through? Anyone? So position in list is 0, so element is 20. Okay, so I say L1 of item. Okay, L1 of item. So if I say item in range of this, so item will take the values given by this list. So this list is taking the values from 0 to 5. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, then I pass this as an argument. This is an index to, I am passing item as an index to L. Okay, so what happens? I print position in list 0 is this. Okay, right. How much more time is left, Reena?
I'm 20 minutes
more. Only 20 minutes more?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So again, you can check these. How you can process strings in loops. Okay, this is syntax of while loop is something similar. What you are going to do is, you will initialize the looping variable, you will specify a condition, and then this is the body of the loop. Okay, there's a small difference in the syntax, but rest of the tasks are same like the other programming languages. Okay, initialize the looping variable, specify a condition, and then this is the body of the loop. The body of the loop must be indented to the right. Okay, so hope you have understood this. And then let me move on to functions. Functions are very important concepts in Python. So how you can create a user-defined function is using the keyword def. Okay, so you can, I'm creating a function with the name hello. This is the argument to this function. Okay. So I can mention, again, the function definition begins after colon, okay, not a curly braces, we are not using a curly brace here, just a colon you mention, and then intend the function body to the right, okay. So there's only one statement in the function body, I'm just returning hello followed by the argument, okay, plus we'll print this, okay, right. Now I call the function. This is something, same syntax in other programming languages. Name of the function followed by the actual argument. This is the formal parameter, this is the actual parameter. So what output I'll get? Let me run this first. And then I'll get hello, job. See here? Okay, so whatever name you mentioned. Similarly, I define another function. Name of the function is sum numbers. It takes three arguments. Okay, it is simply returning the sum of all those three arguments. So again, if I run this, okay, so 4, 5, 6, the sum of all of them is 15. Okay, so again, I have given some more examples of how you can print the even numbers. Even numbers. So this star operator will help you to take a sequence of values as input. Okay, that you have to understand. The rest of the things are same. Okay, so when I call this function even, I can pass n number of arguments. So the star operator here indicates I can take any number of arguments. Okay, so I pass a list of numbers here and then I print only the even numbers. Okay, the lambda functions are very handy functions that you can write on the fly. This is very much useful in many of the times in advanced Python programming. So this is a temporary function that you write by using the keyword lambda, okay, followed by a variable name and a colon, and this is the statement. This is the function body. Okay, what I do here, I take any input variable x and then I just want to square it. That's it. I just want to square it. Okay, so now if I run this, I'm finding double star square root or square. I'll be getting 6, yeah, square. Okay, 25, square of 25 is 625. Okay, and similarly, I write a lambda function. The name of the lambda function is division list. Okay, I take each element and then square it. Okay, if it is divisible by, I'll just display the square of this number only if it is an even number. Otherwise, I will display ABC. Okay, you understand the definition? I take a number as input. Okay, I'll display the square of that number only if the number is an even number. Otherwise, I'll display ABC. Okay, what do you think the output for 8? What is the output for 8 for this problem? This function is going to return the square of the given input if it is an even number. Otherwise, it will display ABC. What is the output of this? Are you all with me, participants? Hello?
Yeah.
Okay, what is the output?
B64.
Yeah. Others? I could hear only one voice all the time. So what should be the output for this, you guess?
ABC.
Okay, because it's an odd number. So since I said find the square only when if it is an even number, otherwise display ABC. Okay. So let me write, there are some more examples here where I print even if the number of characters in the given string is even. Otherwise, I print the actual name itself. Okay, I give a sequence of strings as input, and then if the number of characters in the given string is an even number, then it will print even. Otherwise, if it is odd, the number of characters in the given name is odd, then it will print the name itself. Okay, so that is what it is going to do. So here again, it will print for Raj, Raj, Rajveer, Rajveer, and Raja and Rahul. Rahul will print even because there are even number of characters in these two names. Okay. Right. And then the lambda function, the same task, something similar to that. Print even. If there are the same function, I am converting it into a lambda function. Okay. So for each x, print even if it is divisible by, if the number of characters in the string is divisible by 0, which means if it is an even number. If the number of characters in the string is even, then print even. Otherwise, print the name itself. So, the same function I have converted into a lambda function. Okay, let me move on to the next topic because we don't have time. So NumPy is a lot more than the basic arithmetic operation that you can perform. It will help you to do advanced mathematical operations. So NumPy is a library Python package, okay, which you can use to do advanced mathematical operations. So it supports the basic data structures that it supports are arrays, okay. So it could be a single dimensional array, which are called as vectors. Two dimensional arrays are called as matrices, and the multiple dimensional arrays are called as tensors. Okay, so you can handle any type of arrays using NumPy. So there are n number of advanced mathematical functions that you can do that will come by as built-in functions inside the NumPy package. Okay, so you have to use the functions, built-in functions that are available in NumPy package by importing it. So you will say import NumPy as np. The meaning of as np is you are giving an alias name for the package NumPy, because every time whenever you want to use the any of the functions in NumPy, you don't want to use the full name NumPy. Instead, you want to use the shortcut name np. So it's an alias name given for the package NumPy. Okay, that's it. Okay, now I just want to call the cosine function of NumPy. Okay, the cosine function I can call, as I told you, the tab whenever, supposing if I use import, okay, if I want to know what are the commands that start with im, I'll press tab. Okay, automatically I didn't type import now, I just pressed tab, automatically it is printing this. Okay, it is auto completion. Supposing if there are more than, if I say print and then if I press tab, okay, so there are n number of functions that starts with PR. Okay, print, product, profit, properties, okay, all these. Okay, so now I just press once again tab or whatever operation you want to choose, it's like this. Supposing if you want to know if you want to know the documentation of print command, then you will say shift tab. If you want to check the documentation of print command, okay, so these are all the arguments that it takes. There are a number of arguments and each of them are being explained here. You can check that. So the shortcut key for checking the documentation of any of the functions, whether it is library function or user-defined function. So for user-defined functions, you can give documentation, okay? Right, that's what I want to show you. I said I promise I will be showing it. Okay, so now the cosine function, I just want to, there is a constant pi that is available as an element under np package, okay, NumPy package. So pi is 3.14, that is a default constant value identified by the variable name pi. Okay, so I just want to find the cosine value for the pi. The next is I want to find the square root of this value. And later I just want to find the natural logarithm of the exponential value 5.2. So as you know already, exponential and natural logarithm are complementary to each other. Therefore, I'll get the value 5.2 itself. So now if I run this, what I got? This is the cosine of pi. Okay, and then this is the square root of 1.21. This is natural logarithm of exponential e power 5.2. Okay, natural logarithm of e power 5.2. So I'll get 5.2 itself. Okay, now next I can create an array, NumPy array, using an existing list or by specifying a list. So this is a list of values. I create an array. Okay, so since this is a simple list, okay, it will create a vector. Means one-dimensional arrays, we call them as, for creating a one-dimensional array or a two-dimensional array or multi-dimensional array, we are going to use only the array command. Okay, but we call, for our convenience, we call one-dimensional array as vector, two-dimensional array as matrices, and multi-dimensional arrays as tensors. Okay, so now I create a vector. Okay, so this is a name, just a variable name, any name you can choose. I just print this. Next, I just create a two-dimensional array. Okay, so what is the order of this matrix? 3 by 3, 3 rows, 3 columns. Okay, and then I print the matrix. Then I want to find the transpose of this matrix. And then I just want to print the data type of each of them. So if you see here, initially I printed this, and then later I printed the 3x3 matrix, and then the transpose of this, and finally I print the data type of each of them. So for both vector and the matrix, it is showing the data type as nd array. The meaning of nd array is n-dimensional arrays. Okay, it could be one-dimensional or two-dimensional or multi-dimensional. All the arrays in NumPy package are arrays. Okay, but it could be one-dimensional or two-dimensional or multi-dimensional, but the data type is going to be nd array, referring, which means n-dimensional arrays. Okay, the next is how you can create arrange. Okay, arrange is a function supported by NP, NumPy. Okay, you can specify a range of values here. Okay, so it will try to create a list. It will create a one-dimensional array. Okay, like this. So again, the final value is not inclusive. Therefore, there will be 15 elements starting from 0 to 14. Okay, so now if I print, so after printing, I could see the elements from 0 to 14 as a list, as an array, one-dimensional array or a vector. Okay, and then again I use an arrange function, a range function, in which the starting index is 3, not index, the starting value is 3, the ending value is 21, which means it will count until 20, but the step size is 6. Therefore, the first element is 3, the next element is 9, and the third element is 15, and the fourth element is going to be 21. But since this ending value is not inclusive, this value 21 will not be included in this vector. Okay. You have understood that. And then the linspace command is something different from what we have discussed earlier, where it is going to include the ending point also. Okay. It will create a list of values. The number, the third argument indicates not the step, it indicates the number of values that I want. I want 10 different values within the range 0 to 5. So here both are inclusive. The starting value and the ending value is inclusive. And how many values I am going to create? 10 values of equally spaced values. Okay, equally spaced. Okay, starting from 0 to 5. So the first element is 0, the last element is 5, and all the values are equally spaced. Okay. And then the reshape command is very useful command. In deep learning, we generally use this to convert a grayscale picture or a color picture into a grayscale picture or a black and white picture. This reshape command is used to convert a vector into a matrix. And also you can convert a vector into a tensor or a, not a tensor, not a, a matrix or a tensor, whatever it is, according to your requirement. Okay, so this reshape command, I have created 10 L values here. Vector 4 contains 10 values. Okay, now I just want to create a matrix out of this. So this matrix is going to have 5 rows, 2 columns. 5 rows, 2 columns, again 10 values. So instead of a one-dimensional array, the same set of values I want to have it in the format of a matrix, 5 rows, 2 columns. Okay, so let me print this. So after printing, what happens? Initially it was 7 elements, later matrix, 5 rows, 2 columns. This is column 1, this is column 2, this is column 1, this is column 2. Okay, and then you can create, there are some more useful functions supported by NumPy. If you want to create a matrix of zeros, if you want to create a vector of zeros, or if you want to create a tensor of zeros, you can do that by using the np.zeros function. So this function will create, now as in based on the argument, it will create a matrix or a tensor or a vector. Now I want to create a matrix of order 5 by 3, 5 rows, 3 columns. So there will be 15 elements in the matrix, all are zeros. Now, if you want to create a matrix of order 3 by 5 of all ones, okay, you can do it like this. Okay, now I want to create an identity matrix. I is a method function which will help me to create an identity matrix. Since all the identity matrix are square matrix, I don't need to mention the row size and column. Simply, I specify a single argument because it's a square matrix. So if I say 5, it is a 5 by 5 matrix. Okay. So, when I run this, I got see here, this is the ones. This is the identity matrix. Okay, and then before that we had a matrix of zeros of 5 by 3, 5 rows, 3 columns. Okay, so okay. Now again I use the arrange function, arrange function 1, 6, which means the elements would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, the elements here are 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's, each of them is a vector of 5 elements, and I'm going to perform the arithmetic operations on vector. It's very simple. You just mention the main advantage of Python and R programming is you can use vectors, matrices, you can perform arithmetic operations on these data structures just like primitive data types. Two primitive data types, A and B, how do you add A plus B, right? Similarly, two vectors you can add, vector 5 and vector 6. How do you add? The syntax is very simple. Okay, vector 5 plus vector 6, that's it. You are adding two vectors here of same size. You are multiplying two vectors and then you divide 1 by vector 5. Okay, and then you are finding the square root of vector 6. So if you see here, this is 1 to 5. Vector 5 is this, vector 6 is this. And then you have added vector 5 and vector 6. So the individual elements will be added. 1 plus 3 is 4. 2 plus 4 is 6, 3 plus 5 is 8, something like that, okay? And then you multiply them, and then you find the square root of vector 6, okay? Now, you can do matrix multiplication also, okay? Matrix multiplication, you can perform by making use of the function called matmul. Will help you to perform matrix multiplication, right? So, for matrix multiplication, you have to remember the column size of the first matrix must be equal to the row size of the second matrix, right? That is one of the requirements for matrix multiplication. Okay, so now you can solve a linear algebra equation by using the function called linalg.solve. Okay, if you want to solve a linear algebra equation, you can use this method. So I have given the input as mat and product so that I'll be able to get this as output. Okay, so it will be 1x plus 2y plus z, 1z is equal to 8. So the solution, so like that I create equations, linear algebra equations, then the solution for the linear algebra equation is this 1 comma 2 comma 3, where a is equal to 1, b equal to 2, c is equal to g. Okay. And then I create. Okay, how to create random variables? What is this? The previous cell. I'm sorry, it is going a little slow. Again, I create a set of random variables. If you want to create a set of random variables that form a uniform distribution, then there is a function in NumPy, np.random.rand. This rand function will help you to create random numbers that follows a uniform distribution. Okay, so I want to create 25 random numbers, 5,5. I want to create a matrix in which I am going to have 25 random numbers. Okay, that follow a uniform distribution. If you normally create a set of random numbers that follow a normal distribution, you will use a method called randn. So how many random variables I am creating here? 10 into 5. 50 random variables I am creating and storing it in the variable name randmat2. Okay, so here there are 25 elements and here there are 50 elements. So how can you access the individual elements? I think it's easy for you. Hope you know how to access the individual elements, the range of elements from the matrix or a vector. You can do that. This is the same concept for which we have used in list also. So it will fetch 5 elements, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, because the ending position is not inclusive. So it will fetch 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 elements. Starting from index 4, index 5, index 6, index 7, index 8. Okay. And similarly, you can even specify the index to be again like this. So the set data frame. Data frame is like something you can imagine that is like an Excel sheet where you have rows and columns. Okay, so the entire data set can be imported as a data frame where you have a number of rows and number of columns. So unlike the matrices concept where you have the rows and columns format, matrices in a NumPy array supports only to group data items of same data type. In a single matrix, you can have only strings or only integers or only floating point values. Okay, NumPy arrays support grouping data items of same type. But data frames supported by pandas will help you to group many data items of different type. Okay, so you can imagine each column of a particular type. Okay, so data frame is going to have a collection of rows and columns where each column can have a different can have values of a particular data type. Okay, and each column is called as a series. Okay, so in pandas support two major data structures. One is a series, another one is a data frame. Series is you can think of series as a column in a data frame. Okay, so you can create a data frame by combining many series together. Okay, so all the values in the series is going to be of the same data type, but a data frame can have many columns of different data types. Okay, so hope you have some idea about what is a data frame. Now if you want to create a data frame in Python, you have to import the pandas package. So for convenience, I am going to import it as with alias name pd, shortcut name pd, and once again import np, because already I have imported it, is not required. So now I create a list called with some elements. Okay, now out from this normal list, I create an np array, numpy array. Okay, so the difference between a general list and a numpy array list is what? General list can have any data type, can have data items of any type. You can have one element as integer, another element as string, third element as floating point, no problem. But numpy array can have a list of one specific data type. Okay, so here I create a list of floating point values. So from this I create an array of floating point values. Even if you include one integer value, that will be automatically converted to floating point. Okay, so suppose if you have a set of string values and one integer value, if you mention in this list, that will be treated as a string value automatically. Okay, because numpy arrays can group items of same type. Okay, so now I just want to create a series, pandas series, from this numpy array, my array. Okay, so now I just create, initially I just want to create a series from my list. My list is a list, okay, general list. So I use the command pd.series, data is equal to my list. Okay, series from a list, or whether you create a series from a numpy array. But whenever you create a series from a list, you have to be careful that this list contains only data items of a specific type, not a mixture of items, okay, of different type. Okay, now I just print one specific element from the series. So now I want to print the second element, means the element at position 2. So if you see here, the indexes are assigned automatically starting from 0. Okay, so I just want to print the element at position 2, so it is actually 1.7. Next, I can assign index positions to me. By default, the indices are 0, 1, 2, etc. up to the end. But if you want to give labels to your indices, you can do that. So what I'm doing is I create a list saying first, second, third, fourth, and then I just assign these labels as my index. So what will happen is, instead of the default indices, it will create the user defined indices. Okay. So I use this particular, customized indices for my series. Okay, next. So you can use either this format or this format. So if you want to check the, shift tab, if you want to check the documentation of this, you can go and check this. Okay, the series, if you want to create a series, pandas series, the first argument is going to be the data, the second argument is going to be index. Okay, so by default, if you are going to specify, either you can say data equal to my list, index equal to my labels, or you can directly specify the variable name itself. Okay, it will create. Both the processes same. You can use in any of the format. Okay, and then how to access one specific element. So instead of using the default indexes, now since you have assigned custom made indexes to your series, I use that to access a specific element. Okay, and then I just want to add two series. Okay, so my series 5 plus my series 4. So what happens? I have two different for series 5, I have different indices. For series 4, I have different indices. Okay, series 4 has got indices 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th. But series 5 has got the indices as 1st, 3rd, 4th, 5th. Okay, 2nd is missing here. But there in the series 4, 5th is missing. Okay, so if I add both of them, what will happen? If I add both of them, see here. If I add both of them, so it is being arranged in alphabetical order. Okay, so the for the data series 4, since there is no element, when it added, it has become not a number, means null value, it has become null value. Similarly for the index 2nd, it is not present in series 5, right? So again, it has become not a number. Okay, so because you cannot add an integer value to a string, right? No, not a string, it is a null value. Therefore, the result is also going to be a null value. Okay, so NaN stands for not a number, which actually means the null value. Okay, so now if I want to concatenate two strings, okay, if you want to join two strings, two series, what you can do is you can specify, you can use the concat method and then specify the series that you want to join in as a list, and then you specify the axis because I want to join them on column based. Because I want to have series 4 as one column and series 5 as another column. So if you want to join them based on column, then you specify the axis as 1. Okay, and then you don't want to sort it, so you say sort is equal to false. Okay, so if you see here, I have created a... So this will create a... This will create a data frame. Now it has become, because I already told you, you can create a data frame by combining multiple series together. Each series will form a column. Okay, so now it has created a data frame. So there are five rows and two columns in this. Okay, so since there is no equivalent value in series 5, so it is NaN here. Similarly, in series 4, it is NaN here. Okay, so now I create a data frame. I create a data frame. How to create a data frame? pd.dataframe. And then I want to create a data frame by generating a number of random values that follows a normal distribution. Okay, how many values I want to generate? 25 values. 25 random numbers I want to generate in the format of 5 by 5. So as I told you already, it's going to be of rows and column format. So there's going to be 5 rows and 5 columns. And these values are the random numbers that follow a normal distribution. So this is the data frame. Let me display the data frame. Okay, so there are 5 rows, 5 columns. The default indices are for the rows 0 to 4. Similarly for the columns 0 to 4. Supposing if you want to assign your own indexes for both rows and columns, what you can do is you can use the index command to give customized indexes for the rows, and for giving the customized names for your columns, you will use the column attribute. Okay, so I just named the rows as first row, second row, third row, etc. Similarly, columns I named them as first column, second column, third column, etc. Okay, so now if you see here, where is it? Yeah, so for the instead of the default indexes, now the custom made indexes are being shown. Okay, now if you want to access this element. What you will do, name of the data frame followed by second row, second column. Okay, that is the index you will use. Second row, second column will fetch you this value. Okay, see here, third column, first column. So now this one, print df3 of second column will print all the values in second column. It will print all the values in second column as a series, because whenever you fetch only one column, it will become a series. Okay, next I print third column and first column. I print two different columns, therefore it will become a resultant. The output of this command would be a data frame. Whenever you fetch more than one column, it will become a data frame. Data type, if you want to store it in a variable, xyz, if you want to store it in a variable, and if you check the data type of this, it will show it is a data frame. Because we are fetching type of xyz, it will say it is a data frame. Is there an error here? Okay, let me correct this error and then send you. But generally, when you try to fetch more than one column, the data type of that particular result will be a data frame. But the data type of this is a series. Okay, I'm not printing this. Third call. Okay, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't run this or what? Yeah, I'm sorry. So now let me try it once again. X, Y, Z. Yeah, now it's okay. Because I didn't run the previous command. That is the reason why it was not showing. See here. When I print the data type of XYZ, it is printing, it's a data frame. Because when you fetch more than one column, let me display XYZ first, then you will understand. When I fetch more than one column, I have to say print. As I already told you, if you have more than one output, you have to explicitly print it. Okay, so there are more than one columns. In that case, the data type of this would be data frame. But the data type of this is series. If you want, I can print that also. I have to store it and then print it, print the data type. Therefore, I'll get it as a series. Okay, right. And then you can use, this is very important and useful. If you want to fetch some of the data values based on some conditions, okay, supposing I want to print only the positive values in the given data frame, or I want to print some of the values that satisfy a specific condition. So in that case, you can filter the data based on some conditional statements that you mentioned here. Okay, I just want to filter the values available in the data frame 3 based on the condition that for whichever values that are greater than 0, I just want to print them. So the values that don't satisfy the condition, specify the condition, then we have a not a number value. Okay. So again, I add a new column to the existing data frame by creating a series of random numbers. 5 rows, 1 column. Okay. So it has been added, 6th column is being added. So 6th column is being added. Now I want to drop it. Okay. So what will happen? I drop the column, 6th column, and the resultant data frame, I store it in DF4. So if I print DF4, it won't have the 6th column. But if I print DF3, it will have the 6th column because the result I have stored it in DF4. Supposing if you want to drop the column and store it in DF3 itself, you can say DF3. Here, or you can simply say df3.drop in place is equal to true, which is coming below. See here, if you want to drop it, time is up, ma'am. I'm sorry for taking too long. Okay. Okay, combining data frames is very important, like how you can merge. Because when real time, whenever you work with the real time problems of data analytics problems, you may have to combine you have to work with many data sets in which you will import each data sets in a particular data frame and then combine them, merge them into one based on relevance. Okay, so if you have an employee data set and you have another data set department and if you want to combine them for specific reasons, then you can use, this is something, if those are familiar with SQL operations, join operations, the same format. Okay, so I create two different data frames and then I'm going to join them based on a specific column. Okay, since I'm running out of time, how many participants are still there? Okay, can we continue for 10 more minutes so that I'll just show you only how to do the merge operations. That's very important.
Okay,
ma'am. 10 more minutes. Is it fine for the, is it okay for the participants?
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. So this merge and join is very important. Outer join means you are going to perform the union operation. Means this outer join, you can combine two different, you can join two different data frames and then you will specify how, what type of join operation you want to perform. So you can say outer, inner, left and right. Okay, and based on a specific column, you want to combine the rows from two different data sets. You want to combine the rows two different data sets based on a specific common column. So you can join two different data frames only when there is a common column. Okay, so that is the concept similar to primary key and foreign key in SQL, right? Okay, so if two different data frames are having a common column, then you can combine them, you can join them. Okay, so the outer join is something similar to the union operation that you can perform. So what will happen is, based on the customer column, I just want to join, merge the records in it. Okay, only when I show the content of DF7 and DF8, you will be able to understand how it exactly works. So it has got some, DF7 has got some columns and DF8 has got some other columns, and then I just want to join them. So this is the syntax. Okay, so when I perform the join operation, since there is a column, apart from the customer column based on which I perform the join operation, I perform the merge operation, there's one more column that is present in both the data sets. Sales. There's a column sales which is present in both the data sets. So in that case, what happens is, it is creating its own name. So it is assuming the first argument is X and the second argument is Y. So it says sales X is this, sales Y is this. Means the sales column in data frame 1 means the data frame 7 here, and the sales column in data frame 8 here is given a name, sales underscore Y. Okay, so that is how it is being combined. So in customer column, if you check the IDs, in DF7, in DF7, I think, in DF7, there is no record for 102 for color. Okay, for color, in DF8, there is no record. There is no value for color in for record number 102. That is why it is NaN. Similarly, in DF7, if you see here, there are null values here, which means there is no record 105 in DF7. In DF7, there is no record with the customer ID 105. That is why it is not a number here. Okay, so that is how it will try to combine the, merge the records from two different data frames. Supposing if you say write means write merge, if you want to perform the write merge, means similar to inner merge I explained, right? So inner merge is something similar to intersections. Those records which are there in both the data frames. In both the data frames, only these three customer IDs are there. So in DF7, there is an ID 102. In DF8, there is an ID 105, which is not present in both. Okay. So that is the reason why I get only three records. Because only these three records are present in both the data frames. Okay. So now I just want to perform a write join, a write merge, which means it will try to identify all the records that are there in the DF8 data frame and which is also present in DF7. Okay, it will try to consider only the records that are there in DF8. Okay, and the corresponding columns that are available in DF7. Okay, so only these are all the only four records available in DF8. Similarly, if you perform left merge, it will try to identify all the records in DF7 and the corresponding columns of DF8. Okay, So actually, I need to explain this in detail by quoting some examples. Due to want of time, I couldn't do that. I'm sorry about it. And the functions in pandas, this I have explained in previous programs. Like, these are all the basis for data analysis. Okay, so you can check the non-graphical data. You can do non-graphical data analysis. Means you can check how many unique values are there in a particular column, how many records are having a specific value. Okay, say for example, the unique command fetch you, what are the unique values for color? Okay, so the value counts command function will fetch you how many records are available for each value. Say for example, there are two records in the data set. There are two records in the data frame DF8 that takes value green for color. There are one record in the data frame that takes a value blue. Okay, so this value count method is very useful to know the distribution of values among the records. Okay, so when you perform univariate analysis, it will help you to identify how the, you say for example, the salary. If you have a column called salary, how the values are being distributed among a set. How many people are having the salary ranging from 10,000 to 20,000? How many employees are having the salary ranging from 50,000 to 1 lakh? So that kind of analysis you can make using the value counts function. Okay, so similarly you can find the mean. So this will, if you say data frame dot mean, this will give you column wise mean. So if you have a column of type numerical type, then for each column it will try to give you the mean value. Okay, there are two columns in DF9, there are two columns Q1 and Q2. Okay, similarly if you want to know the names of the columns that are present in your data frame, you can use the columns function that will display you the columns. And then similarly, you can write user-defined functions to process the individual columns. So if you want to find the sum of the column values, you can do that by writing user-defined function for that. So you can group the records, means based on relevance. You can group the records. Supposing I want to identify product-wise purchase details or customer-wise purchase details, that is grouping the records based on some specific attribute. Okay, so if you want to know how many customers have bought a particular product or how many customers have bought a specific product. So all those details can be identified by grouping the data based on a specific column. So here what I do, I want to group the data based on customer. Okay, so here there are three different customer groups, customer 1, customer 2, customer 3. And each customer is buying, the information available is during purchase 1, they bought product 1 of quantity 1.1. Again, during purchase 1, customer 1 bought product 2 of quantity 8.20. So this is the information available. So you want to group it. So customer 1 bought product 1. What is the sum of the products that he bought, the specific customer? Okay, how much product customer 1 bought in total is 2.1 plus 1.1, which is 3.2. Okay, so such kind of grouping you can perform by making use of the group by function. Okay, so these are something similar to the SQL group by, which you have performed. And I think that is the final one I had. So we will be doing advanced, if possible, we can do it in the future, because I have already done some of the detailed data analysis and data pre-processing tasks which I have done for another college. So since this is meant for students, I made it very simple. I just want to make a comparison between how the other object-oriented programming languages is different from Python. So all those comparisons and some basic information about how you can do basic data analysis tasks in Python. That's what we have covered today with the limited time. I think it will be useful for you. It was useful for you. Thank you very much for your patience and time.
Thank you, Marshall. Thanks so much, Marshall. Participants, you can ask your questions. Unmute your audio. If you have any query, you can unmute your audio and ask your questions. Anybody else? You can ask your query and unmute your audio.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. For doing a projects or mini projects, which are the things we have to concentrate, ma'am?
Which are the project in the data analysis, in the data science projects. Yes, the basic thing in data science is the EDA, exploratory data analysis and data pre-processing. That is the initial step that you have to do. Now, today we have discussed only the very basic of Python, which you have to know to go proceed further. Okay. I did some of the programs on exploratory data analysis and data pre-processing. That is the first step in data science projects. And then you will go with model building. Okay, whether you will go for supervised learning techniques or unsupervised learning techniques or whatever, depending upon the problem statement, you will choose a specific machine learning model, build the model, test the model, and once you are satisfied with the performance of the model, you deploy it in the production. That is a series of operations that you perform in data science projects.
Okay.
So you will analyze, you will evaluate your model based on various parameters like accuracy, recall score, and precision. These are some of the parameters based on which you will evaluate the performance of your model once you have built it. Okay, for building a machine learning model, you can use a simple supervised learning technique like linear regression or logistic regression or decision tree, or you can go for an ensemble technique where you will combine multiple techniques together. Okay, and so you will try applying multiple machine learning models, compare their performance, and then finalize your model building with one specific procedure if you are satisfied with this performance. Okay, so once your model is ready, save it as a file and then deploy it in the production. Okay. Are you from academics or industry?
No, I am a student, ma'am.
Student, okay. So if you want to really do a simple project, you can begin with EDA, how to do EDA, how to do data pre-processing steps, and then build a simple machine learning model with a decision tree or a linear logistic regression, whatever it is, or it depends which machine learning algorithm you are going to choose. It depends upon the domain in which you are going to work, okay, based on the problem statement.
Okay, thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Participants, you can ask your questions and your audio.
This is Priyanka, ma'am.
Okay.
Your presentation was very nice and useful for us.
Thank you.
So what are the opportunities available for us? Available for the job opportunities for the
data scientists in this domain you are asking, data scientists?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Now every company wants to recruit a data scientist now because of the technologies that are available for model building and other things. Artificial intelligence is a very booming concept, and even a small business, they want to have a data scientist to improve their return on investment. They want to invest on analyzing their data, how they can promote their business. So based on all these requirements, they want to engage at least one data scientist. So if you are going to build your career in this domain, then you will have a good scope in the market.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Participants, any other queries? Okay, ma'am, shall we wind up, ma'am?
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Once again, I thank the management and principal, ma'am, and all the organizers of this event for giving me an opportunity. Thank you very much. And also the participants, thank you very much for your patience.
On behalf of our management, principal, faculty members, I give you a great honor to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first thank Almighty for making today's occasion a resounding success. I thank our Kamal for your encouragement and motivation towards the post of the Halma. For our informative participants got well loved both theoretical and practical. Thank you to make our time very useful, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I would also like to thank our supporting staff for making all arrangements and for their contribution, especially to Pedinda's Department of IT, Anwar and Pedinda's Department of BC, and also Rosina Varin, Pratila, and Nimravati. Finally, I sincere thanks to all the participants at the webinar preparation. Participants, the feedback link posted in groups. So kindly fill up and get your e-certificate. Thank you all participants, and thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I have shared the email here on the screen. And those who have any further queries or any other guidance, please feel free to contact me on this email. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.